Okay, Mr. Charles Bibbs, this is our second quarantine as co-founder of this event. Just wanted to get a little bit of feedback on how you think this project went. This is our wrap-up. We did our 3 weeks worth of work, and we just finished on our exhibition. And I just wanted to get some of your thoughts on the project this year.
Okay, well, as far as I'm concerned, it was okay. It was okay for me as an artist, but I was handicapped in a sense, more or less playing as the host rather than one of the artists. So I think in the future, that is something that we'll have to address and make sure that all the artists are free to create without any personal entanglements or any personal obligations that are basically there by way of being too close to home. So, you know, you can't, you know, if you got those responsibilities that normally happens when you're at home, it's easier to detach yourself from those if you're, you know, 3,000 miles away.
Mm-hmm. So. Well, you had a lot of responsibilities this past 3 weeks with all the other exhibitions and other projects that you've been trying to get closed off in for the beginning of the year.
Yes.
So how did this program fit into starting off your year as far as Gallery 626 is concerned?
Well, I think it did good for the gallery's sake. It did very well. I think the community interest in the quarantine was evident by the way they responded at the reception. And we did get some visitors during the quarantine, which was another gallery element. I think it'll probably be better not to use a gallery to hold the quarantine, because then you're mixing the responsibility of the gallery to be a gallery when you close it down for something like a workshop. So I think that wasn't a good decision on my part. So, it's a learning process. So, you know, we'll do something a little differently next time. But I think the key to it is that you find artists, and as the word quarantine means, to separate oneself from any normal situation, and you have to be in an isolated situation in order to take advantage of the principles of the quarantine. So that's something that we need to work on.
We invited two other artists this year, one abstract artist, one abstract figurative artist. Can you give me some reflections on having worked with both of them on this year's quarantine?
Yeah, one thing is good about the quarantine is that as artists, when we relate to each other, we only see the end results or the end product of what an artist produced. The quarantine allows you to witness the actual process that's being performed by these different artists. And I guess at witnessing that process, you learn a lot. It's not like being in school where one artist is trying to teach you something, but I think it's the observing these artists in their different capacities as artists and their techniques and stuff. Then you learn so much from that, and then a lot of that stuff you started experimenting. And I think in the experimental phase of the quarantine, that's when you pick up different techniques from different artists. And you also pick it up by just getting into a dialogue. Dialogue is very important in the quarantine. You know, And I think that I have to put that on the top of the list of it, of benefits with the quarantine. If you get into that dialogue, you can talk about different techniques. You can ask questions of, you know, why artists are performing their techniques in certain ways. So you pick up, and during that process, you learn.
What would you say were some of the things you may have come up with in this quarantine that wasn't in the last quarantine?
I think
in your personal work.
I think once again, I think it was forcing oneself to experiment, forcing oneself to break away from their normal concept of doing things and trying different techniques. And then once again, getting into that dialogue, you know, getting not, you may have one observation and one conclusion, but then you can get in a dialogue with your partner or the other artist and get their opinion on your experimentation. And I think that's good too.
Mm-hmm. If you had to sum up a couple of things that you think will move this project forward after having done it with four artists this year, what would a couple of those things be?
I think that the most important thing is knowing each other, getting an opportunity to spend time with your fellow artists and getting them to know. And we know a lot of artists, but we don't really know them. We know them by names, we know them by their works, but we haven't got a chance to talk to each other on an extended period. And I think after the quarantine, you're closer together. You know, when you say, well, yeah, I know Charles Bibbs, now you'll be able to say, I really know Charles Bibbs because I spent 3 weeks with him in a quarantine environment, and we had a chance to really go beyond just acquaintances. Mm-hmm. So I think that is key. So later on, when you know, when people are reading about the relationships of artists, okay, I think I will be able to articulate on a Larry Poncho Brown from a point of really knowing who Larry Poncho Brown is. See, and I think that's what the quarantine gives us an advantage for artists that are participating in quarantine, more so than just you happen to meet up with an artist, shake hands, I haven't seen you in a year, that type of thing. Now, it means more. Now, when we greet each other again, and we embrace, and we shake hands, it's different. It's because there's a closer relationship because of the quarantine.
What if you had to give me the title of one piece you did this year that gave you a good feeling, what would it have been? What was the one piece you did this year, or two pieces you did this year, this year's quarantine?
It would have to be those pieces I did with splashing paint on the paper. I think that whole looseness and a way of getting a creative blast, rather than a tedious, long process, now you get a creative jolt.
Well, tell me a little bit about that. Just explain a little bit about that technique. I know you use some non-traditional materials, and you use some tools that really aren't part of this culture. So maybe give me a little.
Yeah, well, we had those Chinese paintbrushes, mm-hmm. where we just dipped the brush in a bottle of ink and just splashed it onto the paper. Mm-hmm. You know, and then we blacked out different parts of it, and I think I don't know. It gave you an idea that creativity doesn't have to be laborious. Mm-hmm. It can be spontaneous. Mm-hmm. You know, it can be just a flash of creativity. It doesn't have to be a long, drawn out process. Mm-hmm. And there was the old saying that I think Picasso said it, that there's, if an artist can start something and stop it, and once he stops, regardless of whether he's finished or not, because he stopped the piece of artwork, it's finished. So any period in the process, the creative process that you stop, it's finished. It doesn't have to be the traditional ideal and concept of being finished. So I think I've got a good idea of what he meant when he said that.
If you had to give me one sentence of what you learned from each artist, what would it be?
I think what I learned from each artist is that I think the...
Specifically? I mean, with Deborah Shedrick and with Gwen Redfern and myself, what would you say were things that stood out this year?
I think there was one thing that stood out, that and that is that we're not different, you know. I think in a great sense, we're basically the same.
That's a powerful statement.
Yeah.
Do you think it was what did you expect to happen from this year's quarantine that didn't happen?
Well, I think the only thing that I expected to happen, I guess it would only relate to me. I think the things that was supposed to come out of the quarantine did come out. The quarantine was only two to three artists before. Now we're talking about four artists. In the future, more artists are going to even have bigger results. But I think everything that I expected to come out of the quarantine did happen. It did happen, and I think it was, and it's all about relationships. I think it was all about, not so much about the artwork, it was about four artists who've come together who before may have only had a relationship in passing. Mm-hmm. Now we leave with 3 weeks of continued, constant, you know, relationships, and I think we build a stronger bond between these four artists. And I foresee in the future that you're going to be able to look at maybe 100 artists, and they'll all have a really close bond. And I think, and because of that close bond, I think we'll be able to do a lot of things together. Whereas before, there's always been an element of, you know, not sure about each other, or distrust, and the dissemination of information and stuff like that. And I think the quarantine is going to help break down those walls of distrust, or those break down those walls of unfamiliarity among artists. And I think that's important. That's more important than sharing artistic goals and techniques and stuff like that.
Along the way, we've come up with a couple of different ideas and some things we would like to incorporate into this project, including a book and some other things. So
Right. Maybe
give me a couple of highlights of what you see as being the future of this event.
Oh, yeah. The future of this event, when we establish a more documented presentation on what we expect and what we want to gain from this program, I think you're looking at the possibility of getting grants. We're looking at the possibility of sponsorships. We're looking at possibilities of a film presentations, full color catalogs, books on the experience of these different artists who have participated in the quarantine. So I think it's going to evolve into a more of a cohesive organization. I think, who knows, it could even evolve into a more of an elite club of artists, or membership of artists, where, you know, every year there is a camp or something that's a quarantine where everybody's looked forward to coming every year and spending 3 weeks together. So it'll be like a convention of sort, okay? And I think, and it's gonna be something like where artists can have their own conventions and look forward to every year like other organizations. See, that's something that is missing among professional artists. We don't have a national or international convention. This quarantine could be something that emulates that to a certain extent. But it'll be different because it's all based on creativity, it's all based on dialogue, and also based on building friendships among artists.
Right now you have a major exhibition going on of African-American art at the Metropolitan Museum in Riverside.
Mm-hmm.
Give us a little bit of feedback on how that project is working. And
it's the resurgence of black artists on tour. And it's my dream and continued ambition and aspirations to put African-American artists on a level where they should be. And to have a representation of traditional African-American art tour the United States. And I'm talking about not a whole lot of artists who have deceased and going forward, but contemporary working artists today, to have an exhibition that travels to major museums. And I'm not talking about local galleries, I'm talking about major museums. This is something that I feel strongly about, and we're going to investigate better ways to make that happen.
This exhibition at the Metropolitan is a landmark exhibition.
Yes.
Is this not the first time they've done an African-American exhibition?
This is the first time they've ever done at a Metropolitan Museum in Riverside. Hopefully this is the benchmark or the first stepping stone in a series of exhibitions. What I envision is artists, contemporary African-American artists, loaning art to artists on tour so that we would have current works by contemporary artists on tour at any given time. And I think what it's also going to do for these artists is going to build up their resumes. It's one thing to have exhibitions in local galleries. It's another thing to have a major exhibition in a major museum. And this is some of the thing. This is something that is far in between for African American artists. And one way to gain that experience and to gain that opportunity would be to do it collectively. So that's what the Black Artists on Tour is all about. Is a way of bringing all our resources together and collectively being able to put shows on at a higher level. And that is the objective, and I think we're accomplishing our objective to a certain extent.
All right, Ms. Sedgwick, we're at the end of this project. 3 weeks, and we just had our exhibition yesterday, and I want to try to get some overview from you of how you feel about the project. You're an invited artist this year. Based on the merits that you've put into the business, your work ethic, you were also invited because you were a figurative / abstract artist. And I just wanted to get some feedback on how you felt about the project. So tell me what you think are some of your concerns you had coming to the quarantine issue.
My biggest concern was probably working that close with other artists for that long period of time. Because basically I am alone in my own little world creating what I create. So that was my biggest concern, was I kind of tend to have to be in my own space, and I had to live and work with other artists for 3 weeks. I was excited about it, but I was also apprehensive. But now that it's over, I had a lot of fun. We got to know each other better. I think it helped our business, and we grew, our personal relationships grew. I saw Gwen at shows, we shared booths, but I think we are closer friends. I've known Charles Bibbs for a long time. I knew Charles Bibbs before he was, quote, Charles Bibbs. I hadn't spent a lot of time with him, though, and I got to see the human side of Charles. He's a very funny, whistling kind of guy. And as far as Poncho, we've known each other for a long time. We've been close for a long time, and I think this made us even closer.
If you had any creative apprehensions, what do you think they were coming into the quarantine?
Any creative apprehensions? Not being able to create. I have not ever been the type of artist to create in front of other people. Only in the last year or so, I have been able to probably finish a painting in the presence of other people, but basically, that was something that was just mine, to be able to create in an environment where I didn't need anybody else. I don't need anybody else to create, and I think that was my biggest concern, not being able to create.
The body of work you created, and that probably consisted of around 50 pieces. Were you happy with the work that was produced here, or was there some things that didn't turn out the way you wanted them to? I mean, what was your overview of the work that was created in this last 3-week period?
Well, before I got here, I had an idea of what I wanted to do. I had an idea of pieces that I wanted to work on. That didn't happen because I had a commission that I was working on, a project I was working on. So my focus was on that project. And so I had to tie in the quarantine with my commission. And that was really heavy on my mind. But I did it. And I'm happy with the work, because I had to come out of my box and create something that was specific. I had to do specific colors. I had to do images that related to something that was not what I would normally do on a phone basis. I would have liked to have had more fun with this project, but I had something else on my mind that I had to do. But other than that, I think everything turned out great.
At the reception, we had a couple hundred people show up. You sold quite a few of your pieces. You saw some family. I know you had ties here to California. So how was it to be quarantined in California without actually being able to?
That was kind of hard, because I know a lot of people here. I have a lot of family. I was not able to go out and have a good time like I would usually do. I had to focus on my work. There's a lot of people that I didn't call. I am so sorry. But I plan on coming back to make it a fun trip. It was a bittersweet trip, because this was home for me for a long time, and it brought back a lot of memories, and it brought back some things that I thought that I had pushed in the back of my mind. This was really an eye-opening experience for me. I grew a lot. I realized that I have totally become a different person than when I left here. So.
You work with Gwen Redfern probably the closest, because your two workstations were close together. Explain to me some of the things that you experienced working with Gwen Redfern and the type of work that she does versus the way you work.
Okay, I saw a lot of myself in Gwen, the way she works. She stuck to her schedule. She was disciplined. She worked she worked hard, and I work hard. And when I looked at her work, I was like, well, I'm not on the wrong track, or there is somebody out there like me that works crazy hours and works all the time. So I enjoyed working by her. I had a different perspective on my work by working next to her. I found myself really looking more, what should I say? I found myself really looking at my work more and searching for images. I could see her, she would just stand back and look at her piece for a long time, and I could see that piece speaking to her, and she would draw out certain, well, the images were there, she had to find them. So I found myself doing that more in my work.
Well, your other counterpart, your other partner was to your left, was Charles. So what were some of the things that you think rubbed off of you from watching Charles work?
Charles has such confidence in his work and how he executes his work. He paints happy. He's whistling and joking, and he brought out the lighter side of everything when he was present.
And if you had to ask yourself, if you want to explain this project to other artists that were reluctant to participate, what would be some of the things you would tell them that they would gain by participating?
I would say, if you want to grow, if you want your business to grow, you need to coexist with other artists. And that just doesn't mean coexisting when we're at a show together and saying hi and bye. We need to share our ideas. We need to know each other's ups and downs. We need to know what pitfalls we've gone through. And I think working together this weekend, we shared all that. I think everyone should experience this at least once. No one's ever done this before, and I'm glad that I experienced it, and I would do it again.
If you had to pick one negative thing that happened to you during this experience, what would it be?
Well, I fell down the steps. Really? I don't have any negatives, because I try to learn something from everything that happens to me. And I don't try to look at life negatively, because that would only bring me down, and I like to stay happy. So I'm not going to say there was really anything negative about this experience.
And I mean, whether it be schedule, whether it be trying to balance schedule, whether it be pressure to produce, I mean, not negatively spirited, but was there a particular challenge that you had in this environment? I mean, here you are, you're living with artists, you're working with artists, you've got different sleep schedules, different work schedules, different attitudes, different mood shifts. So what was your biggest challenge?
My biggest challenge then was probably being focused. I think I was focused, but I wanted to be out in the streets too. And I probably wanted to socialize a little bit more. And I know what I was here for. And I had to keep that in the forefront of my mind, that I need to produce a certain amount of pieces in a certain amount of time. And that's what probably was the hardest part for me.
What would you say was the most positive outcome of having been in this kind of environment? Not that you're in this environment often.
I think.
I mean, what could you say you left with here as something that you could use to further your career as another level?
I think my perspective on my work and my perspective on the way that I do things has changed. I don't think that we're all going to go out and just change the way we do things, but seeing the way other artists work has to give you a different perspective. I think you raise a lot of questions about things that you do that you wouldn't have raised if you weren't in this environment. It just opened up a whole new world as far as seeing people in the same industry. We're basically doing the same things, but we are doing differently. And seeing each artist doing things different from you has to make you have a totally different perspective on what you do and how you do it.
How did living downtown LA affect your expectations with this project?
I like the hustle and bustle of the city. I would try to take a walk and look at new things. I'm a people watcher. I enjoy watching people. I enjoy looking at the structure of the city. I enjoy trying to find my found objects on the sidewalks and in the streets. I would probably like to be in a downtown environment.
As we approach our third quarantine, and the prospect of inviting two other artists and possibly doing another city, what would be some of your expectations if we did continue this project?
I think I would expect, let me think about that, some of my expectations. Basically,
yeah. You've been here for 3 weeks.
Okay.
You had to prepare another week or so to come here. You had to clean off your schedule. You had to make sure your expenses and everything were met while you were gone. You had to so you came here with expectations. Some of those got dispelled. You've gone through this process. We did the exhibition, and now you say, okay, if I was to go forward with this project, what would be some of the things I would like to draw from? Because I know you didn't have a chance to maybe filter through a lot of this right now.
Everything was an element of surprise for me because I didn't know what to expect. But now I know what to expect. I think I would expect for us to do, I would push myself to do more work, I think.
You seem discouraged with the amount of work that you produce here.
I'm always discouraged with the amount of work that I do.
Is there any particular reason that you were discouraged with that number based on what the other artists were producing?
Well, I know me and I know what I can produce. I won't have to question my ability to create with other artists. I've jumped over that hurdle. But I think my expectations would be for, you know, I don't even know if I could answer that question right now, because I really think things turned out okay. To look at footage of how the room looked when we were working and to see the work hung on the wall, and to see the customers come in and to see a sale, it was all worth it. I think everybody had a good time. I think everybody learned something. I think my expectation of running my business is greater. I've learned a lot from this experience.
Here we are at the end of the Creative Quarantine 2007, our second actual Creative Quarantine. We had a wonderful experience this year. Last year it was me and Charles Bibbs, and this year we decided to invite two other artists, Deborah Shedrick and Gwen Redfern. Redfern is a abstract artist. She uses oils, mediums oil on canvas. And Deborah Shedrick, who is a partial abstractionist and
a figurative artist, so he uses acrylic. And I think what happened this year was tremendous, with two different perspectives, two additional perspectives in the project. I think that it forced us to think outside of the box a little with our approach to doing our personal work. Me and Charles Bibbs are both very figurative in our approach to doing our imagery. But they come from a different perspective. And so that had an effect on both of us as we took it to do some different work this year. So I think this year's quarantine had many dimensions that the first one didn't. One is that we were downtown LA. It was a very congested, busy area. It was a quarantine in the true sense of the word, in that we spent most of our time in the actual gallery, which was converted over into a workspace for the four of us. But we all stayed on task. We stayed in the studio, and there was pretty much somebody working around the clock for 3 weeks. Gwen Redfern tended to keep her home schedule. She usually awakes at 5:30 at home in Raleigh, North Carolina, and she was getting up 2:30 in the morning. Myself and Deborah Shedrick are on two different schedules. I usually wake up around 9 and I work through till about 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning. Deborah Shedrick takes naps throughout the day. Charles Bibbs has been running back and forth between Riverside and here, so there was someone in the studio practically around the clock. And to see that kind of work ethic being exercised has to affect you at some point. And I'm sure that showed up in the work. We were able to create over 120 pieces, which, barring the circumstances, is a tremendous number, especially when you see the content of the work. Again, this whole project was put together to be an experimental situation where artists gather to share information, and number one, to share creative energy. And the byproduct of that is that we end up discussing a lot of business, ideology towards the business. The one thing we all have in common is that we're all full-time artists and have been full-time artists for at least 10 years, in Gwen Redfern's case, and 20 years in the case of myself and Charles. And the same with Deborah Shedrick. She's been doing it for at least 20 years. So that wealth of information, you can't get anywhere. You can't get a booklet on that. Artists are known for being individuals. So getting an opportunity, number one, to work together, which is not something that we do often, to fellowship and to talk about the business, is something we rarely do. We may meet on the road. We might see each other at shows. But the majority of the time, it's just hello. We have that kinship on the road, but to sit down, talk about the things that are working, the things that are not working, the problems that we have that are in common, trying to balance this existence is a magical thing. And adding two more artists was a wonderful experience. Our vision for this project is to eventually have 10 artists or 20 artists that meet and do this on an annual basis. And we're also thinking about this project traveling to different states. A lot of ideas were thrown on the table with this particular quarantine. We had representation from Baltimore, Maryland, myself, Raleigh, North Carolina, Brooklyn, New York, and Moreno Valley, California. So with all of us traveling the country pretty much to do our business, there were a lot of nice ideas that were thrown up on the table. We're attempting to add two more artists next year, so we're going to begin the selection process for that. We also think we may have a location for next year, which is great, and we'll be working towards that. Along the way, we've discussed the possibilities of doing a catalog to document the pieces that have been created during the quarantine. I even have thought about even doing a reality TV show that's based on the same subject matter, because I think most people are curious about the mindset of creative people. But we'll see. The momentum of this project is great. This has been our second year, and really looking forward to what's going to happen next. What I learned from Charles Bibbs in this quarantine is his confidence with his work is tremendous. I mean, there isn't an ego, there isn't an arrogance. I guess some people probably would view it as that, but being a creative person myself, he just has a sense of his purpose when he's working. So, and I can't say the other artists don't have a sense of purpose, but there's a certain lightheartedness and a definite confidence with his approach to doing just about anything. We watched him do very intricate stuff with his world-renowned cross-hatching, and there were times when he would just take a big Japanese brush out and hit a big piece of 28 by 40 paper with G. Clay toner ink, of all things, and when the colors overlap, they mix, and it was nice to see him have fun with those. Working with him is an amazing energy exchange for a creative person, because his mind is always thinking. He is not just a right-brained artist, he's a right and a left-brained artist. Artists that are right and left-brained are wonderful people because they come from a lot of different perspectives. And he's the kind of person, if he comes up with an idea, it's going to be implemented. He's the co-founder of this project, and was not able to put in as much time as some of the other of us, but he's sponsored this whole project. Gwen Redfern is from a completely different side of the track. Most of us do figurative work. She does totally abstract. Most of us do acrylic work, and she uses oil, which is a very slow process. So watching her come in, set up with us, and pretty much defy her medium was pretty incredible to watch. I watched her also ship her work in, and it was very organized. It was already pre-framed, and so she was able to keep up with a faster drying medium without losing integrity with her work. She's very disciplined. And I can't say everybody here is on task with discipline. You can't create the body of work we created and not be disciplined. It's so funny, the misconceptions that people have about us being here in California, in LA. Most of us had a discussion that most folks think that we're here on vacation. And we're not on vacation. You know, we've been working very, very long hours, very sustained hours for 3 weeks. And I tell everybody to kind of imagine if you have a hobby, and that hobby, someone comes up and say, hey, okay, you can do your hobby for 3 weeks. No phone interruptions, no family interruptions. We're going to isolate you in an area where you can do that hobby. And you're going to go, wow, that's pretty great. And then add to that, well, with that hobby, we're going to provide three more people that have the exact same interest as you, that love this hobby as much as you do, and we're going to put you all in one spot for 3 weeks to create whatever you feel like creating. That's basically the premise of what happened with this project. The difference is, by us being full-time professional artists, that there's a certain seriousness and there's a line of discipline with it that doesn't happen with a hobby, okay? We all live, breathe this work. This is what we do, and we have realized that was our contribution from the creators, is what we were meant to do. And so from a simplistic standpoint, that's what we did. But to be in a room with other folks that are doing that, it really makes you motivated. Most artists have to be self-motivators, and they're very isolated. You know, start hearing themes from each one of us where we spend a lot of time alone, we create alone. You know, we're all of us have been black sheep our whole life with the people around us, sometimes even with our family, in regard to our talent and how we approach what we do. Not to say that we're better or worse than anybody, but we have a different perspective and we kind of react to things differently. So when you're in a room with three other people that of like mind, certain things happen. Most artists spend most of their life justifying who they are to everybody, because everybody's curious and they just want to know. but they don't really get a chance to really step into the mindset of another creative person. When you're in a room for creative person, there's certain things we don't have to say to one another because we've been through it, we've been doubted, we've been all, you know, every other positive and negative thing you can imagine happens. Another thing that typically happens is because a person is creative, people who are not creative will look at us and go, hey, look, oh, that's a God-given talent. You got something that I didn't get. And that can be hurtful to a degree because it just erases all of the commitment most artists have to their craft. So we live and breathe this. We see this stuff all the time. Being in a room with another person that understands that, you can strip yourself down and have fun, which is something I think a lot of us lose sight of doing this full time, because there's so many different elements that we have to tend to keep our businesses rolling. The one thing we often do in these quarantines is we discuss some of the strategies we've used to keep our businesses afloat, because the art business is a very difficult business. It's a very dog-eat-dog, aggressive business that, you know, it can be a difficult business to manage, especially if you got a lot of people who are promoting the business that really don't have the artist's best interest in hand. And so we've learned how to be more savvy with how we approach our business. And the good thing about being in a quarantine is we get a chance to really exchange a lot of information. What approaches we've tried, which things have failed, which things haven't failed, which people were leery, which people were positive, which people are doing cutting edge things. Most of us now are online. We were able with the quarantine to pretty much put work up on live as it was created on one of the websites, and hopefully next year we'll have a specific website for our creations so that people can see it online and maybe have some web streamers so we can see the actual work being done. Our web response has been tremendous. Last year, Charles and I and our quarantine created 115 pieces, and then we were also joined by Cynthia St. James last year. I would say that 98% of those pieces were sold, and I would say that 80% of them were sold online. So that's going to change immediately. We had about maybe 3 pieces from our portfolio this year that were purchased online as we were creating them. And during our exhibition, we may have sold 14 pieces, which is a great, great thing that we can expand on as we attempt to do this. One thing that we need to stay on track of is continuing to share information, continuing to work together, continuing to stay on the cutting edge of what's happening with our business. I think one of the things I was most impacted by during this quarantine is the work of Deborah Shedrick. Having watched her the last 15 years enter a stage in her life where she has gained momentum with her work, it was really nice to see her whole approach to doing her work. And I think we all were quite amazed with what she was able to produce and her work ethic. She is using a non-traditional media, palette knife, which is it's loose, but to watch her mix all those colors and using this palette knife where you're scraping everything together to make an image, I think impacted on all of us. I think I did my first non-figurative abstract as a result of her and Gwen Redfern. I think Charles was influenced by their looseness with his very bold, colorful figures that he did this year. And I think we impacted on them as well with our composition and the way we work. But again, I was pretty blown away by each person's approach, and I think that I'm really looking forward to adding 2 more artists to this equation to see what's going to happen. A lot of things happen in this quarantine that, you know, that are bound to happen when you're in an environment. We actually lived here, worked here. I mean, it had all the elements of a TV show, of a reality show. It really did. And that's something that we're actually looking at. It's like, well, hey, if this is what happened with what we're doing, I mean, what would it be like if we put a situation together where we invite artists from different walks of life into this same quarantine environment and really let the world see how we think, how we live, some of the idiosyncrasies that we have. And I think people will really be amazed and have more of an appreciation for how artists work, create, how their lives are lived. You know, that's part of what we need to do is to kind of share the information, and maybe it'll make more folks go out to galleries and appreciate the work when they see it and the whole process. Maybe support their children more if they're showing artistic talent, because we're in a time right now where we're in an environment where most art programs are being closed in schools. And we're running the risk of having a next generation of artistically barren children. Technology is alive and well. It's a plus and it's a big negative. If you take an art class and convert it to a computer lab, you're engaging one side of the brain, but one side is also being left kind of dormant. And so we take this pretty seriously. Most of us have a commitment to artist advocacy. Most of us speak at schools. Most of us work with children. Most of us engage the community. Most of us support nonprofit organizations. I mean, so we do a lot of stuff that most people have no concept that we do. It's pretty much look at the work and they say, hey, look, this is what they do. They do pretty pictures and I want that on my wall. They don't have any idea, not only the commitment level and the time intensiveness of what we do, but the other things that we're doing to keep this thing going. Now, we're in the education business in a world that sees art as the lowest common denominator. I mean, it is not bread, butter, or gas and electric. So when the economy is tight like it is now, we really get, the artists get to know right away what the economy is doing. But, you know, we also have been able to survive, artists, in every aspect of our lives. A lot of us don't realize how much art is a part of our daily lives, because everything that we do, see, breathe has been designed, created by a creative person. And it goes to a lot of different hands before it gets to us. But the bottom line is we're in the backbone of our culture. When they talk about documenting our history, they use art, literature, writing. We're right in the core. And so we're really doing work that's designed with us in mind, and also documenting our mindset for this period that we're in. We're in the midst of a major art revolution right now. Not since the Harlem Renaissance has anyone really began to pay attention to what's happening in our realm. And so, no one's coined a phrase for it yet, but I'm willing to bet you someone's going to coin a phrase for it soon. And I'm hoping that the efforts that we put together to continue to unify artists will possibly help contribute to what the title of that next revolution is going to be.
Okay, we were down to our last wrap-up of this exhibition, The Creative Quarantine 2007. You were an invited artist this year, and you were selected because of your work ethic, and you were also selected because of your medium, the fact that you're an abstract artist. Can you tell me briefly what you expected before you came to the quarantine?
What I expected was to pretty much see how much work you can get done in a three-week period, to actually spend time with other artists and work with them in a, you know, closed environment.
What would you say was one of your major concerns if there was a negative concern coming into the quarantine?
Would I be influenced by the other artists in the sense of their style of painting? That was my major concern.
Okay. What would you say was maybe a couple of points of things that you learned from being here in the quarantine? Things that you think that would enhance your business or you as an artist. Not that 3 weeks would change your whole outlook, but if you had to pick one or two things that you would say you would take with you from the quarantine, what would it be?
There's certain techniques that the artists use that I don't use. that I could apply to some of my pieces. That's pretty much what I got from it. Just like I said, for Deborah Sedgwick, watching her use the palette knife, watching her how she mixes her paint and how she applies all the different colors on her onto her canvas. Watching Charles Bibbs, how he starts a piece and how he works into it and then finishes it off with all the fine detail that he does. And then watching Larry Poncho Brown use his special gift in his graphic illustrations and how he applies his certain techniques and puts it to the canvas or to the paper. And these are things that I don't do. And I might have seen it before, but never really paid that much attention to it until this past 3 weeks. And just gave me some more ideas as to, you know, like I said, how to apply it to my work, how I can work it in. And that's a good thing.
You probably worked the most strenuous hours in that you were trying to stick to your East Coast schedule, which means you were getting up at 2:30. Did that impact you in the way you were working? Did it help you keep pace with how you normally work at home? Or do you feel like it threw you out of balance a little bit trying to work that kind of a schedule?
It didn't throw me out of balance. A lot of getting up in the morning, that's basically my schedule when I'm at home. And actually my schedule at home is even a little bit more different than that. If I'm seriously working, I have I break it into 3 work periods. So I work for 4 hours, take a break, work for another 4 hours, take a break, work for another 4 hours. At this time, I got up at 2:30 and I will work to probably about 10 or so, 10 or 11 or 12, and take a break, and then come back down. It gave me a period where I was able to focus a little bit without everybody being around. Just get my thoughts together as to, okay, what am I doing? Let me look at my piece and give myself some direction. And then it allowed me to, when you guys, both the people, the others in the group came down, like I said, I could spend that time, I could still work on my piece, but I know what I was doing at that point. And be able to watch the rest of you guys work. And I think that was an advantage that I truly enjoyed.
What would you say was a distraction being here in this kind of environment? I mean, most of the time we were working around the clock, and so there really wasn't a lot of room for entertainment or other things. But what would you say was the one thing that distracted you the most with the way that you work? Even if it's personal stuff, because you know we were living in closed quarters. We were pretty much with each other most of the day. And all kind of things that happen within that kind of a period. So if this tape was going to other prospective artists to participate, what would you say was one of the distractions you had to cope with over this 3-week period?
Well, I think it was, when I really look at it, it was a small distraction. It wasn't, and it's up to the division where they like, if they blow it out from perspective. To me, it was pretty much dealing with everybody else's personality. You see these artists at the shows, and you know, you say hi, you hug, you go out to eat, stuff like that. But you really don't know them until you've actually been with them 24 hours a day, living in a closed environment like this. I mean, because they have their ups and downs. They have the little things that might tick you off, and I have little things that might tick them off. But you don't notice it until you're living with them. And like I said, I had to put into perspective, well, you know, I have to understand that person and where they're coming from and not let it, you know, blow me out of the water or, you know, get really upset about it or anything. Sure, I got a little upset, but I had to get over it and go on. And that's, to me, is how you learn. And to me, it is important that you learn how to deal with other individuals in this world. Mm-hmm. If anything, that was probably one of the biggest lessons that I got out of this quarantine. It's just being around people in an environment where you can't leave.
Did you find it, did you find the level of professionalism that each artist has as plus, a negative, or a mute point being here to quarantine? No, because everybody comes from different sides of the track, but we're all basically full-time artists trying to survive doing art. Did you see that being a plus? Did you see that as being a mute point that wasn't discussed the way you thought it would be? Or did you find that you got quite a few things that you could take with you after this 3-week period that you would have not normally have gotten if we were on the road doing shows?
I found it as a plus. And there's a lot of things that I can take and use when I leave here. Everybody came to the table with different perspectives. They come, like I said, four different areas. And each one of the artists had something very valuable to offer. And like I said, it was information that I never would have received if I wasn't here at the quarantine.
You probably had the most difficult medium here. Everybody else was acrylic artists, use acrylic medium, which dries pretty quick. And did you find that to be a hindrance with the flow of things, or how did it feel to be the odd man out in that respect with using oil versus acrylic? Not to say that one is better than the other, but I know your medium is much more fragile and it takes longer time to dry. Did you find that tripped you up with your planning?
For sure. I came here with a goal maybe to do about 50 pieces. However, with the oil, it just took a little bit longer. The way I paint, it took a little longer for the oil to set so where I can go back into my piece and work. It threw me off a little bit the first week because I was looking at the other artists and see how quickly the pieces, they were doing more work than I was. And I was like, oh, I'm moving at a slow pace.
Did you find that to be an issue? Were you challenged with the fact that folks were working at different paces, or did it take you a while to settle into your own pace?
No, I did at first. I found it to be a bit of a distraction. It threw me off, but I talked with some of the people that work closely with me, my best friend and a young lady that works with me doing the shows, and they were just told me to do what you do best. Don't worry about everybody else.
Exactly.
And once I did that, I felt pretty good.
When we were selecting artists, we chose artists based on a couple of different factors. We were pretty amazed at how organized you were coming into the show. You probably were better organized than all of the artists in the regard of having your pieces already framed. You took time to prep all of your pieces before you left, and you probably had the most efficient shipping. So were you able to see that come into play as a positive, or were you too caught up in the momentum of things to notice that you were probably more organized than most of the other artists that came to this event?
I didn't notice, it didn't put into play. My thinking wasn't that I was more organized, I didn't think about it that way. It took me a while. As I've been a professional artist, I've learned to, okay, I gotta write things down. What do I need to do before I get here? So I wrote lists of things that I need to do. And that aspect, when I do that, I usually am organized when I, put everything together and wherever I'm headed, I've got everything in order. I wasn't planning to buy any frames when I got here. We have a frame shop. Well, the way I normally work it is my mom cuts my frames or everything, makes my frames for all my canvases, regardless of whether the picture is finished or not. Working with oils, usually I'll sell a piece, I just finished painting it and it's walking out the door. So the frame protects the piece from being smudged because when I wrap it, the plastic is actually laying on the frame and not the picture. So I'm not really worried about the oil being disturbed while it's being transported to wherever it's going. canvases had to be prepped. If they weren't, then it would have taken a lot longer for me to finish the pieces. So I prepped the background of some of the pieces, just at least the first layer to get it going. So when I got here, I can work on them. And I normally work on 7 pieces at one time. That way, if I've got 5 pieces going, 2 of them could be sitting and the oil can be setting up while I'm working on the others. And I'll work those period of time and then I can switch out and work on some more. But the packing, you know, I just want to make sure everything got here in good shape. It took me a while to pack it, but now I know what I'm doing because I really never packed for shipping before, not at the extent that I did at this show. So I want to make sure everything got here safely.
What would you say was the one thing you can leave here with after the last 3 weeks in your body of work that was a twist, a different direction, or something you'll probably look more into after you leave here from the body of work that you created? Because I think you created roughly 28 or 29 pieces?
Yes.
In 3 weeks, which is an amazing number. Have you ever created that number of pieces in that amount of time before?
No. Not in 3 weeks.
And my next question, do you feel that those pieces would be put in a different quality category than the rest of your works if you were exhibiting them in a booth just because of the nature of this project?
The first 4 pieces that I did while I was here falls pretty much in line with what I normally do. It had figures in it that you can see. It might take you a minute, but you can catch some of the figures. At that point, I realized that my focus when I came into it was to leave the figures out. So every piece after that pretty much were no figures. Mm-hmm. That challenged me to go beyond, you know, knowing that if I put a figure in it, I'm safe. I had to challenge myself to create it. I'm an abstract painter, so to work on shapes, forms, and colors, not dealing with a figure. And I was pretty much satisfied with what I did. I was happy with my progress. When I take the pieces to my next show, I believe people will be happy with what I'm doing. They will see a new twist, a new direction. It's still abstract. They still know that it's my work, but it's just going to be a little bit more, I think, more refreshing in a different direction, and I believe people will like that.
So we understand that you're now getting ready to embark on opening a gallery in your area down in Raleigh. And we're right now considering the possibility of doing a quarantine at your gallery location. How do you feel about the prospect of doing that? And what do you think, what would you expect as an outcome if we decide to go that route?
Well, actually I'm looking at it. I think it would be exciting to have the group of artists to come down to North Carolina. I hope that do come to a decision to have it there. I think it'd be good for Raleigh, North Carolina, people in Raleigh, North Carolina. I'd like to start promoting that and letting people know that we got a group of fine artists who are known all over the United States, and you need to come check them out. We don't have anything like that in Raleigh, North Carolina. We've never had a group of artists of our culture come down and of great standing and come down and spend time in Raleigh, North Carolina, share what they're capable of doing with the people of North Carolina. And I think it would be a great experience. I think North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina has a great setting for artists. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have a lot of artists in Raleigh. Right downtown, there's plenty of shops. There's something about North Carolina. It's a peace of mind. It's very peaceful. It's an area where you really feel like creating. I think it'll do the artists good that come, and I think we'll all have a great time.
If you were going to promote this project with other artists, What are some of the things you would tell them would be a byproduct of participating?
The, if I could say, camaraderie, being together with other artists, giving a feedback interaction of what you're doing, what they're doing. The fact that you're not disturbed by the outside world in a sense that, you know, if you're home, if you're married, the wife called, the kids are like, Dad, I gotta do this. You have to stop what you're doing and go see to it. Well, you know, when you're away from home, they can't call and say, Dad, you know, or Mom. You're like, well, someone else is gonna handle it, you know, because I'm not gonna fly back home. You know, it's like you're there and you have 3 weeks, 4 weeks to devote totally to what you love doing. And to me, when I first got here, I was like, boy, I'm ready to go home. I'm ready to go home. But the last 2 days of the quarantine, I was like, man, I wish I had a few more days. You know, it's an experience it can't convey until you actually do it. It's a great experience. The ups and the downs. You'll be like, Dad got it. He pissed me off. She pissed me off. And then the next moment, you're laughing. You're seeing people singing, dancing, whistling. It's, you know, you never see the artist like that. You know what the shows? I mean, we're cutting up everything. We're burping. I mean. Snoring? Boy, I've never heard snoring like that before in my life. I mean, you know, it was a really, really enjoying time for me. And I'm glad you invited me. I'm so glad I came. Because I had my doubts, but I'm so glad I came. And I would love to do it again.